Every year, hundreds of comedians trot out their power on the fringe, many making the track solely under the misapprehension that the festival is a make-em or break-em experience. Much of this feeling can be traced back to Beyond the Fringe, the most important and one of the few truly groundbreaking comedy shows in the festival's history. Harry Thompson, who's recently written a biography of Peter Cook, explains its significance.
War is a psychological thing, Perkins, rather like a game of football.
Yes, sir.
You know how in a game of football, 10 men often play better than 11?
Yes, sir.
Perkins, we're asking you to be that one man.
Sir.
Peter Cook and Jonathan Miller in a famous clip from Beyond the Fringe, famous mainly because it's the only bit of that show the BBC didn't throw away. That little scrap of film is all that's left of a show that was possibly the only comedy show that actually really did change the way that people laugh, the way that people think, and in many cases, the way that people vote. In 1960, Edinburgh was a sedate city of respectable middle-aged women in tweed skirts and earnest students in duffel coats. The Tories were in power on the back of three successive election victories, but there was a whiff of sleaze and sexual scandal in the air, and people wanted a change. I know, it all sounds really rather familiar, doesn't it? To borrow someone else's phrase, not a lot of people know that Beyond the Fringe wasn't even a fringe show at all. It was actually the official festival's answer to the burgeoning fringe. They wanted to get their own young Oxbridge comedy show up here. I think they thought they were going to get straw boaters, stripy blazers, a smile and a song. What they actually got was a comprehensive attack on the establishment of a kind that was just totally unknown in 1960. The show opened here at the Lyceum Theatre on Monday, August the 22nd, and it was just after the main evening performance of the Old Vic's production of The Seagull. The serious actors who made up the Old Vic cast weren't even prepared to allow a bunch of graduates in their silly little comedy show to go into the theatre at all until the very moment they went on stage. So they had to rehearse Beyond the Fringe here, in the flat they'd rented at 17 Cornwall Street.
Not bad, is it? Typical student flat from 1960.
And so I become a miner instead. I managed to get through the mining exams. They're not very rigorous. There's no rigour involved, really. It's a complete lack of rigour involved in the mining exams. They only ask you one question. They say, who are you? And I got 75% on that.
There was Peter Cook, who'd written most of the material. Jonathan Miller and Alan Bennett had come up with the rest. And a little pianist called Dudley Moore, who was too nervous to contribute much. The really confident one on the surface was Peter Cook. He was articulate, he was well-dressed, he was dazzlingly witty, but underneath it, he was a bag of nerves too. He'd always meant to be a diplomat, but just after leaving university, he jumped off that particular train, so everything was riding on this show. He couldn't sleep very much as the first night approached, and one morning he sat here at 5 a.m., writing to his mother and watching the dawn break over Edinburgh Castle. Not many tickets had been sold for the opening night, but he needn't have worried. After that night, there wasn't an empty seat at a performance of Beyond the Fringe for 5 years, in Edinburgh, London and New York. Even the likes of President Kennedy and the Queen queued up to attend.
Edinburgh is when people write it as to lay low the mountains of the earth.
I can't hear a blind word you say.
You're speaking too softly for the human ear, which is what I'm equipped with, so... You'll have to speak a bit louder, I think. No better, is it?
Audiences had never seen anything like it. Peter Cook came on stage and impersonated Harold Macmillan, a comedian on a British stage impersonating the Prime Minister. These days, you'd want your money back if you went to an Edinburgh satirical show and somebody didn't impersonate the Prime Minister.
Perkins?
Sir?
I want you to lay down your life.
Yes, sir.
We need a futile gesture at this stage. It'll raise the whole tone of the war. Get up in a crate, Perkins.
Yeah.
Hop over to Bremen.
Yes, sir.
Take a shift, dear.
Yeah.
Don't come back.
Right, you are.
Goodbye, Perkins. God, I wish I was going too.
Goodbye, sir. Or is it au revoir?
No, Perkins.
It does seem to me, not only from watching that, but it occurred to me watching that, that not only was Beyond the Fringe a very groundbreaking theatre piece and a very groundbreaking fringe show, even though it wasn't a fringe show. But they also went on to make some of the most groundbreaking television and stuff that became a template for how the sketch show was to live on for the next 30 years.
Yeah, I mean, what surprised me when I was going to the book was how much the Monty Python stuff had originally been, was in that not only, but also, it was a Peter Cook, and sort of mid-60s, he was doing stuff that was pure Monty Python. Like, you remember Python always used to have those philosophers' football matches?
Yeah.
And stuff. Peter Cook and Dudley Moore did a good v evil cricket match, which is absolutely, you know, it was the Marquis de Sade and Long John Silver against Gandhi and the Pope. And, you know, Dudley Moore dressed as Florence Nightingale, the Marquis de Sade taking Dudley Moore over his knee and whacking him with a spiked bat. It's absolutely straight out of Monty Python. But, and also running sketches together, which is something Python was supposed to have invented. It was Peter Cook.
Right. Maybe that's because they were the first comedians to come from a university background, because presumably, pretty much prior to this, it would have been your musical, yeah, your vaudeville, your working class comedian.
I think that's true. I mean, there was a little bit of, just before Beyond the Fringe, that, you know, there had been a Bamber Gascoigne show, amazingly, gone into,
really,
the West End, but that was still quite traditional. Yeah, Peter Cook was meant to be.
More than anything in the book, you've shocked me that Bamber Gascoigne's name would be put forward as
a radical stand-up. Absolutely. Now, there was a sense. Yeah, you're quite right. And Peter Cook was supposed to be a diplomat. He was going to be in the Foreign Office, and he just, you know, he jumped off, and that was quite a big step, I think, for a well-brought-up middle-class boy in those days to become a comedian. I think his parents didn't mind. You know, they said, okay, if it's what makes you happy, but. Big thing to do.
I think the other interesting thing is that the last few years there's all been this comedy is the new rock and roll. That was obviously, yeah, happening then. I think was this the first show where comedians were considered pretty cool rather than the same stuff that your mum and dad would watch?
I think so, yeah. It's interesting. I mean, all the Beyond the Fringe people were very much part of the establishment. That's one of the things that marked them out. I mean, all the papers said, well, radical, satire, etc. But they were always at pains to say, no, we are middle-class boys. Certainly, Jonathan
I think
Miller.
I Dudley
was from Dagenham, yeah. But Jonathan Miller and Peter Cook particularly always said, no, this is us. You know, we're just taking the piss out of our own kind. And they never hid that.
I think Peter Cook actually also went on to live that proper rock and roll lifestyle, probably more than any other comedian,
yeah.
Certainly the Britons.
Yeah, well, he was bizarre because he was friends with the Sex Pistols. You know, one of his big mates in the 70s was Johnny Rotten, and, you know, Johnny Rotten came around to his house, and, you know, he had, it's really bizarre behaviour, but he offered Johnny Rotten a big basket full of boiled sweets. He said, take a boiled sweet, Johnny. And Johnny put his hand in, and it was loads of syringes in the bottom of the basket. And he could go straight from that to playing showbiz golf with Bruce Forsyth, yeah, and Tarby the next day, and they all thought, it's our pal Peter
Cook.
But
isn't the amazing thing about him is that he could fit in anywhere, but didn't really fit in anywhere either. When, yeah, I first saw him, I think it was probably Revolver. I was probably about 11 or 12, yeah, when Revolver was on TV. And I just thought, what an incredible fellow. I thought everyone, when they got to a certain age, was this funny and this, you know, this anti-establishment.
It'll happen to you,
eventually, and,
you
know, yeah, one day. Oh, Harry, don't make it a personal threat. But no, it did seem to be all things to a man. I know someone very well who was a close friend. I'm not going to name drop at this point.
Why not?
But he said that no matter how close you got to him, he was always performing.
Yes.
Because that was his public platform, obviously not at home.
I think only his close family and, you know, talking about really close blood relatives and his wives didn't get that performance. I mean, people who were his very best friends would still go and see him and get half an hour of stand-up comedy. Didn't necessarily happen at the beginning when he was at school or university, but the people who knew him in his first year at university were complaining that by his third year, you know, by the time he was doing Beyond the Fringe, all he did was do jokes. He just previewed material or did good old material or worked on a routine just while he was talking to you. And I think he was just absolutely had that compulsion to make people laugh that makes people A, a great comedian, and B, a bit mad.
Sadly, in those cases, the only time they can turn off is at home, and
yeah,
that's when the people at home are going to get what's often seen as the dark side.
Yeah.
Do you have any insight into what he was like in his home life?
Well, I've got a lot of stories, you know, but it wasn't easy, I think, being married to Peter Cook. I think he was a manic depressive, and it was probably undiagnosed, because in those days it wasn't so easy to diagnose. Also, in those days, if you were a showbiz alcoholic, it had to be kept hidden. You know, you couldn't do the Royal Variety performance if you had a drink problem. These days, it would be all over the news of the world, and it would be, help this man. But no, in those days, it was all at home, and if you were his wife or his daughter's, you could sometimes hit the other side. He was very good, very, very good indeed, at switching on nice, polite Peter Cook, which was actually the main Peter Cook in public.
But when you're writing the book, and you're obviously a fan, and in a sense, who isn't a fan of Peter Cook, the public person, wasn't it scary learning all this and thinking, God, I've got to be the messenger, I've got to be the bearer of bad tidings?
Yeah, it was. I mean, I started out, obviously, starting writing the book, I thought, well, Peter Cook, great man, I want to write a book about him. And then about halfway through, I actually almost began not to like him because of this great trail of damaged lives in his wake. But by the end, I really began to sympathise. You know, when you realise the kind of thing you can go through, when you had the life he had, and you know, even and but fame ever, is very destructive. I came round to him.
Did you ever consider that there would be stuff? I'm sure you didn't in the finished version, but thinking, I don't want anyone to know this about him. He's being a cook.
There were one or two things I didn't put in the book because of that.
Right. And I'm sure at this moment in time we can't discuss what they are. Thanks a lot, anyway, Harry. Peter Cook, A Biography, is in the shops now.